Welcome to another edition of Yacht Life Chronicles, where we are better together than separated. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you for tuning in to another edition. We're going to go down that line for a minute, man, and talk to Mayhem Music. Opportunity to meet Mayhem Music at Club Escobar down there in Atlanta, 2 Chainz and who was Snoop's spot. And you know, we had the opportunity to just politic. And one thing that I noticed is that her entrepreneurial skills, man, how she just had her hands into a lot of things down there. We had the opportunity to reconnect again. I asked her to do a show and she agreed to it. Here we are today. You know, she's a musician.
I'm getting that bag for real. Down on your luck, swear you mad for real. Hating yourself cause you ain't getting no cash for real. Coming in first so you last for real. Hey, I'm for president, pass the bill. Who got you niggas a pass to chill? Swear I've been real since I jumped in the field. Buzz be on call, who gon' tell me to chill? The little life for pretty, my pockets on feel. I ain't got no spot, but you dressin' to kill. Can't come in the spot, girl, you look like you steal. Might work your move cause you loving the thrill. R.I.P. Kobe, I feel like O'Neal. I shoot my shot, it gon' drop through the seal.
She's an entrepreneur. And we're going to get to know more about her today. So you want to tell everybody a little bit about what it is you do and give everybody your social media tag so they can follow you?
For sure. What's up, everybody? I go by Mayhem Music. That's also my handles on all platforms. Follow me. Like you said, serial entrepreneur. So definitely an artist, actress, video, videographer. I have a job. I work at Enterprise. I'm an assistant branch manager there. You know what I'm saying? I know how to bartend. So I just got my hand in a lot of pots and I've always been that way.
And you know, they say, you know, you can't put all your eggs in one spot, you know, so we see you spread yours out. What make you a multifaceted entrepreneurial like you are? Why you not just grinding down and just doing one thing? Why do you feel you need to do multiple things at one time?
That's a good question. I feel like it's very much obvious that we live in different times now where everything have went up. You know what I'm saying? The price of living, the price of just surviving in general has went up. And so unless your one job is 6 figures plus, you know what I'm saying? Nowadays, we need multiple streams to be able to survive and live. You know what I'm saying? Because I definitely don't want to just survive. I want to live too. I've always been that type of person where, to me, it doesn't make sense if you're working and you can't enjoy yourself as well. Like, I see a lot of people, they work real hard, but they literally just work to pay bills. And I don't really see the enjoyment in that. So for me personally, I've always been the type of person to, like, have multiple things going on. That way I'm not dependent solely on one thing. And life happens, and when life happens, God forbid, if that opportunity is taken, at least you got some other things to help carry you, you know what I'm saying, during those times. So I'm just one of those stay ready so you don't gotta get ready type of people. And I feel like you don't ever want to give that much control to one thing either. You know what I'm saying? Unless you have properly prepared and have really saved up to where if at any moment this ends, you know what I'm saying, you could successfully and financially walk away good. I just can't give my all to one source of income like that. So that's how
What you think about there, they teach you to work all your life and you retire at 65 and this supposed to be the pinnacle of your life where you're supposed to be vacationing and you live. But you done gave yourself so much to the work world as to where I got a bad back. You know, all the money that I save up is going to medical bills. It might be going to your parents' medical bills. And it's like all this money and everything that I done worked for and accumulated through all these years, it really add up to nothing. You know, and at 65, you telling me this is when I supposed to live my life. This is when I supposed to enjoy my life. When I'm basically in the last of the third quarter, well, going into the fourth quarter of my life.
What I say to that is, I feel like everybody's journey is their own. You know what I'm saying? Like, and everybody's creation in this world, what they are put here for, is different. And so, once you do that real soul searching and you really look within and figure out like what your purpose is, then you put together the plan that makes sense for your purpose. That's how I feel about that. Like, we need doctors. We need construction workers. We need all of these people. You know what I'm saying? Somebody does have to do the job. And it's a blessing that there are people that actually want to do the job. You get what I'm saying? But you have to evaluate yourself to say, okay, am I one of those? Or am I someone who I just don't see that for myself? Am I a person that could utilize that 9-to-5 in order to source and fund that ultimate goal that I have for myself? So I feel like it's all about being strategic with your plan, because we can always get money back. We cannot get our time back. And I'm big on that. So it's like how you just said all of those things. It's important to know that you feel that way and then put together a plan that makes sense for the way that you feel. You know what I'm saying? So that in the end, you get what you want and you don't feel burned out. You know what I'm saying? Like, I always say it's a million ways to get $1 million. I'm a firm believer in we don't all have to take the same plan. We don't all have to take the same route. But if you're putting in that work and you got you a plan together that could ultimately get you there, then that's all that matters. So that's how I see it. I've always leaned on 9-to-5s. Like, anytime I felt like things were getting rocky or whatever the case may be, like, I've always been the type that was quick to go get a job. Because one thing about me, like, during the time that most people take to think about their problems, I generally just fix it real quick and still create a new plan. You get what I'm saying? Like, I'll instantly go do something I really don't want to do, because what cannot stop is me making money. That just cannot stop. Like, I don't view it like the way a lot of other people do, where they give themselves months and months and months to be like, oh, ain't nobody hiring. Nobody's hiring that you want to go work for. Like, you're not getting yeses to the jobs that you may want to go do, but you technically could go thug it real quick. You get what I'm saying? And go jump into an industry and get you a job to get on your feet real quick to put yourself in a position to choose. But like, I'm just not a person that sit around for a long time waiting on the opportunity that I want. A lot of times I just get what I can get until I create the opportunities that I want. So,
and that's what we have to do. We definitely got to carve out our own path in life. And when did you get to the point where you knew you wanted to be an entrepreneur, where you knew that, you know, you use your 9-to-5, you know, to fill in them gaps and to help you with your livelihood? But what made you transition into the entrepreneurial world?
So for me, I can say what made me want to make that transition is after working for so many bosses, after seeing how much you contribute to helping run a business, you really sit back and say to yourself, if I could help somebody else, you know what I'm saying, get their business off the ground, go from zero to whatever and actually make something of this, then I know I can do this for myself. And I just started to feel that way after so long of, you know, working for different people, especially, I know you know me to have been in the hookah industry. So like from being in like that club industry and, you know, going working under this person and helping take their business from here to here and then going to go work for this person and helping them get through a drought or helping them figure out why they having like issues with their numbers and what's going on with the marketing. And after doing it so long, I'm like, really, I could have my own hookah business. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, I really, even if I will still go help somebody else get theirs off the ground, because I'm big in helping where I see that I could be an asset. Like, I don't have a problem with working. I'm passionate about being an asset. That's what I can say about myself. Like, if I see an area of opportunity for me to be an asset and financially benefit off of it, I love to jump in. You see what I'm saying? Like, I love to jump in. So I will always be the type of person where if somebody else's business is falling and they see an area where they like, I need May. You know what I'm saying? Like, if May come in here right now, she could help me. I'm going to always be that person to go help them. Like, that's just right. me. But after
and they say you supposed to, you know, a lot of people forget that when they doing things for other people, they forget to take that same thing that they did for somebody else and try to make it into their own. Try to make it work for them. You know, a lot of people do work for other people or learn, you know, do something for other people and they just leave it there. They right. never try to make it into their own. They never try to benefit it from it in their own way. And that's right. what you have to do nowadays. Life is a school of education where you got to learn every second, every minute.
Absolutely. I think the moment you start looking at yourself like an asset, you start looking at the jobs that you work as partnerships. And that's how I look at jobs that I work. Like, I know what I bring to this table. You guys were hiring and I was looking. You get what I'm saying? This is a two-way street. And as long as I continue to bring my best foot forward, then I'm expecting growth from you. I'm expecting promotion. I walk in the door putting my expectations on the table when I go apply for jobs. And I just feel like a lot of times we forget about expectations. Like, we'll just stop it at, okay, I got the job. Okay, but what's the goal? Like, we got the job, but what are we trying to do now? Like, is this something that's supposed to be carrying us from point A to point B? Is it like a seasonal situation, getting over a hump? Is this something where you actually see potential and room for growth and you can actually hit six figures in a short period of time? Like, you got to figure out, what am I doing this for? And I feel like that helps you know how to go into those interviews and actually how to sell yourself and what to actually say. It took me a while before I got it. Like, I promise you.
How do you know what job to look for that lines up with your personality?
That's a good question. That's a good question. I feel like that just goes with job hunting. You know what I'm saying? When you're actually looking through these different sites and you're seeing these opportunities, you have to ask yourself, like, am I good at that? Would I be good at that? Is that something I could see myself doing? Then you also have to ask yourself, can I handle a challenge? Like, this may be challenging, but do I feel like I'm up for the challenge? Like, a lot of times you look at the pay, and if the pay is good and it comes with a challenge, sometimes people are just like, nah, I'm good, because they gonna give me some money, but it comes with a challenge. Like, that ain't something I'm too familiar with. But could you educate yourself? Could you watch a lot of YouTube videos? Like, it's 2024. Couldn't you read a couple books if you really wanted to do that for yourself? So a lot of times people be stopping themselves. Like, it's not that nobody's hiring, it's that some of these jobs that pay good come with a challenge. And a lot of people just don't want the challenge. And that's how I feel.
I think in this era, we got more, it's more idle minds, it's more idle bodies. You know, but a while ago, we had people that were, we had go-getters, we had people that go get it. And now in the internet world, people scroll more than they of a go-getter. Right. They want to watch social media more than they want to accumulate skills.
Right.
We have a generation that have become lazy, you know, with the popping of the pills, the drugs, and, you know, to sit down, scroll, and a lot of people think they're going to scroll their way to success. A lot of people think they're going to pop pills to their way to success. And the thing about it is that a lot of people is living in a facade, a false world, you know, as to where they don't even see their own actions not leading them to anywhere.
Right.
You know, a lot of people lazy in this world. And what I wanted to ask you is that, what do you think, what happened between, in earlier years when people were go-getters and the modern day world, the time that we're living in now, where people is more lazy, they're not as activated to get a job. They're not as activated to get a hustle. They're not as activated to get out there and better their circumstances.
For me, what I think is, I really think it's a product of their surroundings. Like, a lot of people don't realize who they're hanging with, honestly. Like, they might hang with people who they don't have to work to make money. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to dig too deep in it, but I will say, me and you both know there are a lot of different ways and streams of avenues of income that people are tapping into these days. A lot of them aren't legit. So when you're around people like that, or when you're, like you said, scrolling and you're looking at people living a lifestyle like that, where it's like, all I'm seeing is material stuff. I'm seeing this great life, but I'm not seeing work behind it. I don't even know what this person does. Like, they're glorifying these things that they're seeing, but not seeing the work that was put behind to get it. So it's like, they don't want to do no work because they're barely even seeing work be done a lot of times. Like, so they're just like, how are they getting it? They must be sitting around posting and people are paying them, or, you know, their idea of how people are getting things is becoming, they're doing nothing for it. And that's not really the case. I don't know what a lot of these people are doing behind closed doors to get the things that they have. Like, and that's really what it is. We just live in a world where people are tapped in and in tune with the internet rather than being tapped in tune with themselves, like, and knowing what's going on with themselves and actually getting out here and doing the work. They're waiting for the game plan to be posted. They're literally sitting down on the internet thinking that this is going to be the day that I'm going to see like $1 million plan today. Like,
and all I got to do is follow the instructions to get
follow
there.
Follow these instructions. That's why so many get rich schemes that people are doing. Think about why so many people immediately start doing like seminars and classes and tutorials, because how many people are at home and don't want to do nothing? Now, I learned how to do nails during the pandemic from the crib, looking at YouTube. But I'm also a student of life. I went to school, and I've always been the type of person to be able to teach myself something and go home with notes and read and study and come back and take tests and stuff like that. So when I had this idea like, hey, I think I can do nails, I'm like, let me watch a bunch of videos. Let me take notes. Let me really study what they're doing. Let me go get the practice hands. It's not going to work the first couple of times because this is new. This is a challenge, as I said. But this is something that if I spend my money right now and say, I'm going to buy all of this stuff, everything that they're saying I need to get this business started right here today, I'm going to take this leap. You think I'm going to sit back and say, oh, well, if I couldn't figure it out, oh, well, that's just a waste of money. I'll jump on to the next idea. No, like, I was determined. I continued to do practice nails and do things like that while I was working from home. All my people will tell you, I did practice hands while I worked from home with a headset on my head, with all my stuff. My TikTok videos will show you me doing that. That's when you're like, I'm determined. I'm going to find time to work on the craft. You know what I'm saying? So I just think it comes down to willpower. It just really comes
And you're right. You're right. You're exactly right. It does come down to willpower. And a lot of people don't like to get past that frustration. A lot of people get frustrated with certain things when they're doing something. But what that frustration does is a threshold that you're getting over. It's some type of puzzle that you're trying to figure out, you know. And a lot of people stop right there at that frustration instead of getting past it, because once you get past that point, that's the breaking point.
Absolutely.
A lot of people not, you know, because you approach a lot of challenges well. You know, you have a way to you get acclimated with challenges, because you from one thing to another. So what's the most, like, since you've been, because I know we're going to talk about your music in just one second, what's the most challenging thing that you've been through up to now since you've been an entrepreneur and musician? What's been the most challenging thing for you?
I would say the most challenging thing is probably learning how to readapt in a world that's like changing tremendously daily. Like, it's not what it was when I was growing up. So like, your idea and your thought process on how certain things would work and how certain things would go, you thought that you had a plan. Again, it goes back to always having that plan. And it's like, you think you have that plan, but then the world is changing, right? And so then you have to reevaluate the plan to be like, do I want to change with the world? You know what I'm saying? Or do I want to now go back and reevaluate the plan and see if I can do it a different way to where I can still, you know, do it with passion and be organic to who I am, but not changing with the world at the same time? So I would say that's been the greatest challenge. Like,
I would. Mm-hmm. Right. And I think a lot of people plans and things are getting upset, you know what I'm saying, in this new world, especially with AI. What you feel about AI?
I mean, they mentioned it when I was in college that it would happen, and it was, I mean, years ago. And I was told that at the end of the day, we're living in an innovative world. And so you need to learn how to change and develop with it. And you have to find a business or something that you can do that that will forever be needed, something essential. You know what I'm saying? So that's why even with nails, like regardless of AI, ain't nobody going to let no robot do their nails. Like it's certain things that will forever be man-made. You see what I'm saying? And so you got to
Right.
start jumping into those industries and figuring out like what is it that I can do that no matter how many robots they create, a robot could never take the authenticity of this right here. You know what I'm saying? So that's what I feel like. You got to figure out what industry you can get into that a robot can't compete with you
Can't complete. Right. And we want to talk about your music a little bit because we know that's been a passion of yours for some time. What made you transition into music?
So initially, as a kid growing up, I started off doing poetry. Like everybody who actually know me from a kid, they knew like May was the one. Anytime we heard on V103 Youth Poetry Slam, my mama had me there auditioning, and I'm winning stuff left and right, just all type of different things with my poetry. I had the pleasure of being on Joyce Littell Quiet Storm. I know you remember maybe back then when she had the poetry. Yeah, and as a teenager, I was able to go on there late night, my whole school listening to me. So it started with poetry, always had a way with words, and ultimately transitioned into music. I'm sure you can imagine after more people hearing me do this poetry thing at that time, they're like, if you put that on a beat, man, you'll go crazy. You know what I'm saying? They like, that's your raw word. So like, you'll be sick if you put it with a beat. And so after time, you know, I was introduced to the studio, got the pleasure of working. Like I say, things have changed. Got the pleasure of working with real musicians that actually played the piano in the studio on beats. You dig what I'm saying? Like, it was just different times creating music for real. Like, fell in love with it, you know, and jumped into the music. And I can truly say, over the years, as I look over like my time with music, it started with me being true to who I was and what I wanted to talk about. Then it became everybody telling you what they think you should put out. And then it became me trying to make some music like that so that, you know, it can keep up with the nows. And then I just started seeing all of these different transitions. And I'm like, at the end of the day, this is a passion. This is something that is in me, not on me, like in real time. Like, I know one thing about me, I'm gonna be successful and I'm gonna be financially set with or without the music. So one thing about it means I got the pleasure of being who I am. Like I get to be that. I don't have to be a puppet. You know what I'm saying? I get the luxury to say, I'm gonna talk about what I want to talk about, regardless of what you say they want to hear. I'm gonna put this out because that's what I'm choosing to put out. You know? And so I had to go through that moment of life where like I just had to wake up and realize like I'm losing the drive for it because I don't want to drive in that direction no more. And that's why I'm not wanting to do it so much. And so now I'm getting back in tune with, okay, I can't let it go. I mean, I live, sleep, breathe music. Like I'm the type of person in my apartment, I live by myself. I'm rapping all the time. I'm spitting. I'm an artist. I make music. I'm creative with my words. Everybody that know me will tell you I'm catchy. Music. I'm in the booth with Tampa. Y'all know how we
Let's
do.
go.
Pop it for real, ain't never getting all. You talking in way out your element. Dog at the bank with a check, I ain't checking for y'all. I ain't gotta move, I could just make a call. Mad cause my poster hung up on his wall. Pray every day while they hoping I fall. Can't be no goofy and sweat at your boss. See you do it for clout, baby. That's where you lost me. Trying to Google to see what this cost me. Y'all walked in and everything flossy. Addicted to me every day like I'm coffee. I ain't gotta speak, let my life do the talking. Been having wheels way before they could park it. I used to let money bust out my pocket. Figured it out and took off like a rocket. Yeah, they mad, I return them the cinders. I'm one of one, you just a pretender. You think we the same girl, you hit like a fender. Swell, tell me who you talking to, Linda. I'ma have a 50 by the end of December. I don't do no drama, that's weak for my mental. Bar after bar, give it right off the temple. They would have thought I was working for Enterprise. I'm charging them all incidentals. I can't be riding around with these niggas. Got bricks in they trunk, gotta jump out the rental. He wanna do what he wanna, treat him like a dog. I'ma put him in the kennel. Why would you wanna play games with another one when you see Tampa and Mayhem the winner? Like, I can come up with slogans and sayings for commercials, all kinds of stuff. So I can't do anything to escape this. So now that I've accepted that, I'm like, okay, so let's revamp. Let's figure out how I want to do it and what all I want to do. And now I know how I want to market myself. And that's why I mentioned commercials. I'm opening to all different areas and, you know, streams and opportunities of music as long as I get to be creative in who I am. So,
right. What you think about the music industry now that they're getting rid of the talented artists for the more popular artists? So here it is, we got a artist that's full of talent, but that's not as, don't have the popularity. Then we got the artist over here that has the popularity, but don't have the talent that the label is keeping. So now we have a bunch of popular, non-talented artists, and the real talent is getting pushed out. What you think about that?
All you artists out there, especially the ones who got talent, record companies are having a hard time. They're signing all these TikTok go viral people. They're realizing that just because they have numbers on social media, it does not always equate into album sales and streams. So what they're doing now is they're going back to signing artists who actually have talent. They're trusting A&Rs, executives, presidents to sign things because they think they sound great and not because of how many followers they have or their analytics. This means that if you've been working and you didn't stop, you might have a shot. Turn the lights on.
What I think about that is, at the end of the day, we have to always remember that the music industry is business, period. And so that part of it that you're speaking on is more so where we tap into with like emotion, because music make us feel. So like the music that make us feel, why aren't y'all liking this? You get what I'm saying? But yet the music that's making us lose our minds and having us crazy, why are y'all? It's because they're not in tune with their feelings when it comes to this. They're not concerned or considerate with the fact that, like, we know that this music has the effect to change. We know that, like, if we put it out there, too much of it, they have no choice but to start going in, tapping in, tuning in to the positive messages and stuff. But they already see, what are they spending their money on? All of this stuff that's talking about, you know, this, and the third, they seeing what got them going crazy. So they're not going to take their foot off that pedal. Like, they don't see the reason to. They've completely removed emotion from it. It's just like, it's not about how you feel about this and how you feel about that. What cuts the check? Period. Mm-hmm. That's what I mean when I say the puppet thing. Like, it goes back into, you start making decisions. Am I going to be a puppet? Because I know what they want. And I know that if I chose to do that, I would get more attention a lot faster. Or I can just be true to who I am because there's other things in my life jumping for me anyways. And if this is something that's truly for me, it's going to pop too. God bless it. You know what I'm saying? That's how I feel about things. So.
And what, and in the music, what was the one of the things that made you stream, that made you switch from putting your music on streaming platforms and just because, like 50 Cent say he just making music to put on his Power Universe shows. And you said you're making music now just for soundtracks, just for different movies. And I think that's unique because you gotta be creative when you marketing this music. And you got like 10,000 artists coming out every day on YouTube, and you just got a plethora of music. But right. I think it's very unique to put it out in a movie, to play it during scenes of the movie, so it can be heard in a different way, because there's just so much music out there, and it's hard to, you know, get your music through.
And see, what I mean by that too also is, like, if I make a song, if I record a song and it's something that, you know, I'm passionate about, a song that's just in me, it's a message I want to get out, whatever the case may be, and I decide to drop that record, what I mean by that is I'm not going to drop that record and put 100% finance behind that song to push that record. I would do that to get it on a show or on a movie before I would do it to get the views and to get the people on the internet to buy in. When it comes to that, it's going to be organic. So if I drop something, let it do what it do. You know what I'm saying? There's no pressure on it. You dig what I mean? Like, if it's that song and it's going to do that, them numbers, then it's going to do it. And then we'll put a budget behind it, because organically, it just did numbers. Like, wow. You get what I'm saying? Like, something where you're really shocked and really waking up to, like, oh, they really was feeling that. That's where it'll be for me now when it comes to that. Like, I'm just not willing to 100% put all of my eggs in that one basket anymore. You know what I'm saying? And if I'm going to financially sponsor it, it's going to be towards like the movies, the shows. And the reason I say movies and shows, when you think about movies and shows, you think about different things are going to happen in movies and shows, different scenarios, different emotions are going to be in movies and shows, from somebody dying, somebody getting married, somebody having a baby. You need music to help, like, get the feeling and get the emotion out from all of these different things happening. So with that being said, the opportunities for you to get real authentic music that's really talking about something out, it'll be easier to get it in those areas because they need that. They actually put out posts asking for music about this, music about that. They need it versus what we're out here doing, the one game plan that most artists got, where it's like, I'm just going to drop music and I'm going to pay for a mixtape, and then I'm going to pay to be going to these open mics, and then I'm going to pay for views on Instagram and all of this. And then where's that getting you? Like, because it, then it starts boiling down to who you really know. Like, either they organically fall in love with the track, or now you got to actually know the right person to even get, you know what I'm saying, some drive behind it. So, you know, I just don't want to play that game no more. That is how
right. Right. Who are some of the artists you look up to? Who are some of the artists that influence you?
Well, I can say growing up, when I first started, you know, thinking about wanting to do music and getting in, becoming an artist, I was listening to Eve. And shout out to Missy Elliott, because I'm going to her concert for my birthday. You know what I'm saying? My mom knows that's somebody that's dear to me. I've always liked her. I used to be getting out of school, standing in front of the TV, looking at 106 in part, watching these videos and stuff, like feeling like, oh yeah, I can do that. So I feel like those old school rappers from back then were the ones that really made me excited about music. You know what I'm saying? But like right now, artists that I do tend to listen to, I listen to Major Nine. I like him. I like Kendrick. Naturally, because I'm a lyricist, I like anybody who got a story or anybody who got real words in their music where they can really play with them words like that. That's the stuff that I'm gonna more so be into. But what I found out recently is that I listen to a variety of stuff. Like, I'm just in love with music. So when people ride with me, they be like, man, you really need to organize your playlist, because he done went from turning in the club to praising him in the church. And now we doing rock star stuff. Then you got country blending in, like, what's going? So I think that
you need to be multifaceted like that. I was just listening at a song. Was it Benny the Butcher? Or Jadakiss. Somebody got a new song out, but it got jazz in it. And that's the thing about you guys, as y'all as artists, is that if I grew up on blues, if I grew up on jazz or contemporary music, and I'm an artist of hip hop, I'm able to implement these different genres into the music.
Right.
You know, and I think that's what make y'all so creative as an artist, where y'all are not just staying particularly in that one genre, where y'all are actually bringing different genres to the hip hop genre.
Right. And now that I'm revamping my style and everything, I'm really feeling more so like combining my poetry, who I naturally was from the very beginning, along with my rap, and kind of creating this like affirmation style of music, you know, where you're like giving people feel good music, things to remind them of who they are, you know, on days when you forgot. Because by the grace of God, I just done been through stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like over these years, I just done been through stuff, and I'm just realizing like, what do the soul need? You know, like I want to keep up with what the soul needs. So
I can understand that too, because you need something that you need to nourish the soul. You know, the souls have to be plenished. It have to be nourished.
Absolutely.
And this music that we have out now at this particular time is not nourishing. It's just so microwave. It don't have any messages. It don't have any meaning. It don't have nothing as to where I could search my soul and find myself.
Facts. And there's no shade or disrespect to any of the artists, because it's time and place for everything. So it's moments where I'm going to the club and I'm turned because that's what I'm on in that moment.
Exactly.
But I'm at 24/7, and these days where days are hard and things are hard and life is hard. And it's like, on them days, what am I listening to? Like, am I listening to something that's encouraging me to go sleep with this person and do this and do that? I didn't need that on that day. You feel me? Maybe on another day, but today I didn't need it. So it's just like, how do we make it right and fix it to where we make this music so that people can lean on something? Like,
yeah. All right. So how has the Atlanta scene helped you with the impact of your music, and how have it been able to be to your advantage?
I can say, because I'm really from here and I bump shoulders everywhere I go, I consider myself to be like Miss Networker. You know what I'm saying? Like, I introduce myself everywhere. Atlanta has been good to me. Like, whether it was with music, they support me. Whether it's with nails, they support me. And my city just showed me that, like, you be good to them, they gonna be good to you. Like, I truly feel like I'm a person that got a face card where almost anything we dealing with, I can make a phone call. You know what I'm saying? Like, we on the side of the road, I got a friend with a tow company. We over here, I got a friend with this. Like, and I purposefully, intentionally build these relationships. It is not by chance. It is on purpose every time, because I always said I wanted a life where all I gotta do is pick up my phone. You know what I'm saying? Like, everything that go on is that easy, where it's like, no problem, cool. This going wrong, no problem, cool. We make this call, like, we make it happen, period. Like, and it's possible. You just gotta be that type of person that open up, talk to people, check people's temperature, actually be concerned and actually be compassionate, care for real, and then be somebody of value. Like, I'm somebody of value. I can actually say that, like, if I'm listening to you and I hear something that's going on, I could find a way to get in and help on something. There's something going on in your life that I can play some sort of part. I can do something to contribute some kind of way. So I just try to do that with everybody. That way, when, you know, I need those favors or when I need to make those calls, and we're not talking about free favors. We don't want to get it misconstrued where we're building relationships to beg. We're definitely not doing that. We're building relationships to make life easier for ourselves, so that we don't have to go through so much going through, like, the front door when we can slide through the back door. You get what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like, that's what we're doing here. So I feel like that's why, you know, life in general has gotten so much better, because I started realizing how much it was important to build those relationships. Like, going in rooms, keep your mouth closed, don't do nothing. Going to a networking event and not networking is insane. Like, I had to realize, people go out to stuff that the purpose of it will be for one thing, but folks will get there and, like, be on their phone and, like, talk with who they came with. Bye, go over there and network and kick it with them. I came with you. I know you. I'm about to go over here and talk with these people. Like, that's the point. So I can say Atlanta, like, it's good for me because I know how to do it. But do I see a lot of my people doing it? Not so heavily. Like, not so much.
So where did you get that confidence from? Where did you get that self-esteem to just walk up and fraternize with a stranger, to just walk up to people that you don't know, start a conversation? Because I think that's so unique, and I do it myself, because I say you have to be a people person in this world to get where you want to get. The people got all the answers, the people got the money, the people got the keys to unlock any door that you're trying to get through. So you got to be harmonious with the people, and you have to be a people person. Like, where did you get that confidence and that self-esteem from to have that conviction just to be able to get to know people and be able to network with people the way that you do?
100% my mother. Gotta get to all credit to Mom Dukes, because in my younger days, naturally, of course, since I'm a kid, I can't take myself to these events. So a lot of this stuff my mom is taking me to. And, like, I specifically remember there was an event that was being held over off, like, Whitehall Street. It's like an after hour, but they had it going on during the daytime. And it was a talent show where they had 52 contestants, and I'm contestant, like, 49. And I ended up coming in second place and walking away with $2,500. So it was dope. Mm-hmm. But I say all this to say, my mom was at this event. And when it was over, I took my pictures, took my check, and I slid. And my mama was like, my mom pretty much was like, you didn't network with anybody in that room. She was like, for you to come in second place in a room full of strangers. She was like, that was powerful. It was a lot of contestants in there. And she was like, people from all over the state. And I just felt like that was an opportunity for you to bump shoulders, see who was who, just let them know that you're sociable and that you like to talk and, you know, you network and you'll come out and support as well. So she was like, you need to start working on that. You don't want to just walk in a room and walk out, because that could give off the wrong impression. You want to walk in these rooms and actually speak and smile and talk to people and be nice. And, you know what I'm saying, bump the right shoulder so that you can get invited places. So Mom Dukes got me right on together. I'm talking about check me for real. And I left there saying, oh, she was right. She, you know, I can't say nothing. She was right, because that was an event held by the radio. That was 94.5 that gave away that
song. Right.
That was a major event. Like, Story Rock, the one that announced us. Like, I just should have been doing a little bit more. And so I took that to my advantage. I was like, moving forward, I'm not going to let it go by where I go somewhere. And when I perform, everybody who got their phone out, go ahead and follow me. You know what I'm saying? I am Mayhem Music. Let's go ahead and do that. I definitely follow back. We ain't Hollywood over here. I'm getting off the stage. I'm walking up to everybody. Hey, what's your name? Where you from? Y'all want to take a picture? Well, I want to take a picture. You dig what I'm saying? Like, that's all it took for me to get it together. So.
And you get a lot further in life that way.
Yeah, for sure.
You get a lot of advantages that way. But before we get out of here, you know, because you stay on top of them nails, you stay on Nail Evolution, man. You be having some of the dopest nails, man. You do. What I wanted to ask you, how have you seen the art of doing nails evolve over the years?
Oh my God, nails have gotten so exotic and so crazy. Like, it's super impressive, from the girls that do like extreme cartoon to the girls who do the punk rock nails where they got like blood and spikes coming out the nails. The ladies have really been stepping. Like, they've gotten super creative, and I'm happy to say I'm a part of the industry, the community. I'm still learning and growing and whatnot, but thankfully I've gotten a great clientele base, and my people love and support me. Plus, I'm always big on, you gotta notice, certain industries will forever be here. You can't think a market is oversaturated if you're giving something no one else is giving. So we can step in the same lane, but I'm doing my thing differently. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm over here creating a vibe that's unmatched. So I think a lot of times people put fear in their own heart. They discredit themselves, like, before they sabotage their plan, before it even take off, because they're like, okay, but everybody else is doing it. Or the number one thing I see on the internet, none of my people are supporting me. People are cussing out their friends and family because they are not supporting. And then my question to them is, do you think Ronald McDonald got famous and rich off of his family coming to buy burgers and nuggets? Do you think any of these major businesses got where they are because their cousin Ray Ray them was coming to buy a fish sandwich from their restaurant? Like, that is not where their success came from. So your first mindset was already wrong in thinking that the success of your business was supposed to solely be funded and thrived and built off of your circle, like your friends and stuff. That's not how that works, because I hate to say it, most of the time we already have people that we prefer to do certain things for us. So yes, you're my friend, right? But I like my nail tech that I go to already. You feel me? I see that you're doing this and I want to support you, but I got a bond with my nail tech already. And I'm hoping we can still be friends and that you're not mad at me because I got a nail tech already. You see where I'm coming from? And so a lot of people, they looking at it from the wrong perspective. Now what they should be doing, shout out to my minor in marketing, you have to put a budget towards marketing with anything that you want to do. So when you have this idea for this new business, also think of what will it cost for me to help get it off the ground. That way you will eliminate the whole idea of, oh, I'm going to launch this business and I got so many friends, I know they're going to start coming. That's not how that works. And you can't be mad at them for choosing to go other places that they were already going that they really liked. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So like, most of my success when it comes to nails, 95% have come from strangers. God bless it. Like, have come from total strangers. And that's come from me marketing on my Instagram, me choosing to do free specials and promos and being nice and giving back to my community and choosing to do girls' nails half off for their birthday, or letting them pay for one length and giving them a second one for free because it's their birthday. Like, just choosing to be that kind of person, putting character behind business and letting that get you somewhere. Like, I promise it won't fail you. It really won't. So
putting character behind business. Yeah, I like that. So what upcoming projects you got? Tell them what upcoming projects you got before we get out of here. Is there any kind of, you know, go ahead.
For sure. So there are a couple of production teams that I've been partnered with recently where your girl will be in some shows. So look out and stay tuned. Like I said, my social media handle is literally Mayhem Music, spelled the way it is on the screen. Pay attention, tap in, subscribe, all that good stuff, because you'll see me launching those new projects with the rest of the cast members and things like that. I got a little cameo, and then, of course, my music will be in the soundtracks. Stay tuned for that. All things new with nails, you know, I'm creating every day, coming up with dope concepts every day. So book me, don't overlook me. And of course, your girl is the assistant branch manager at Enterprise. So anytime you need one of them black trucks, I see y'all taking pictures. Make sure you hit me up so I can reserve you something lit to ride in. And that's all you got for me today.
Man, and we definitely appreciate this dope interview, man. You know, we appreciate you coming in and giving us this game. Because like I say, you're very unique, man. You're very intelligent. And you're a serial entrepreneur. You know, and I want to motivate some other people out there to be serial entrepreneurs. Take advantage of your time. You have the freedom in this world to roam and do the things that you like to do. Make sure you don't spend your time just engaging in pleasure, drinking, smoking, getting high, the club. Sometimes you have to sacrifice to get somewhere. Sometimes you have to take that and put that on pause for a minute until you can get that business started, till you can find out what it is that you want to do in life, till you can find out what's your niche. You know, till you have to, like I say, you have to come out the world and come back to yourself. Come off the internet. Come out that toxic relationship. Come out the bottom of that liquor bottle. Come out of that cloud of smoke. Come and find out what it is that you like. And not saying that you can't get back to it. You got a lifetime to get back to it, but you got to put in the work and the discipline first to get somewhere. Mayhem Music says she's a serial entrepreneur. She keep a 9-to-5. She's doing music. She's doing film. She's doing this. She's doing that. Anything to keep her busy. She says she don't even sit down and wait and contemplate on even getting a job. That time is wasted. She can be that time she wasting on contemplate getting a job. She can already be working.
Mm-hmm. And I can think about that next job while I'm on them people clock that I know I don't want to be on. But guess what? I didn't go without. That's what didn't happen. So I mean. One thing I want to leave y'all with, though, when you tap in with God and find your true potential, that's when you can reach your ultimate level. Like, I just feel like a lot of us really just don't know yet. We really just don't know who we supposed to be and what we supposed to be doing. So a lot of us is just soul searching. We out here trying to figure it out. We tapping in with so many different things because we're so unsure. So, you know, a lot of times just take that moment to look inside yourself. Take some time for yourself to find out why are you here and what was you created for?
And you definitely was created for progress and not regress. You definitely was created here to make some changes, you know what I'm saying? To evolve some things, to add services to this land, you know, to be unique. You know, you wasn't born to work up under somebody else your whole life, you know, and then they tell you, you get time to enjoy your life when you're 65.
Right.
No, you can enjoy.
You can enjoy life when you want to. It's about how you set it up for yourself.
That's right. It's about how you set it up for yourself. So take advantage of your free time. Take advantage of the education that's in front of you. Take advantage of people that's trying to teach you things as to where, like she said, skills that are not, that AI can't come and take away. Mm-hmm. You know, like she's doing nails. Right. Robots can't come and do that.
They can't. About cutting hair. Nobody want no robot giving them no haircut. Things like that. Even for my women, like, get out of that mindset of thinking that certain industries are built for men. I look at it this way. It's way easier to market and pitch to a man as a woman. Because for myself, whenever I have a product, when I'm in front of a man, that product gets sold. And that's all I'm going to leave you with. That product gets sold. So if you jump into an industry where the men have a high need for that, as a woman, if you're nice and kind and polite and sweet, think they ain't going to buy from you. Think they not going to support you. That's just naturally how it goes. So, you know, step outside the box. That's what I will say. And find your creativity. Like, tap in.
And there you have it. And we want to thank Mayhem Music for coming in, doing this interview. And want to thank you guys for tuning in to another great show. So thank you guys for tuning in to another edition of Yacht Life Chronicles, where we are better together than separate. Thank you guys for tuning in.
Everybody can't just see me. And if you make mistakes, spin the block, it's gonna be too late. Scared to give my heart nowadays. Love too fake.
Show me another side and I'ma feel like it's too fake. I'ma be outside on a nigga like I'm blue face.
Boy, I'ma have you tied up in love like a shoelace. Stay out here playing catch up on the money while I'm too paid. Might be on my sleeve, play with me, you catch a whole fade. Cause I can play more games than a kid at arcade. I'm having options on the topic, but I want you though. When I get you a dose of me, where you gon' want some more. I never been average. On my finger, I won't carry. When you feeling out of place, baby, I'm bringing you balance. And yeah, I've been hurt before, but now I ain't damaged all my little scars. Already wrapped up and bandaged.
Put it all in a letter, swear them feelings I can manage, yeah. I wrote a letter for my friend on V-Day.